لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم على محمد وعليه وصحبه وسلم. إن شاء الله تعالى in this session we're going to have a review of what we have studied so far. الحمد لله we finished the book. جزاه الله خير. Our أستاذ أبو محمد المغربي finished the book. الحمد لله جزاه الله خير. And we would like to take some benefit from this book. So the first chapter, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he spoke about the importance of reflecting upon the verses of the Quran and reciting it slow. Why is that? Why do we have to reflect upon the Quran? Why do we have to recite it slow and absorb it? Why? What's the benefit? What are the benefits that we're going to get by reflecting upon the Quran? I want to open the floor for all of you brothers to participate and tell me what are the benefits of reflecting upon the ayat of the Quran. And now,
you get to understand right what the Quran is telling you, but if we're fast just to finish it,
right,
you're not understanding. You're just waiting to take a burn off.
Right, absolutely. Because when you read the Quran with reflecting upon its ayat, and Quran, some of it is like exhortation, right? And some of it is halal and haram, that which is permissible, that which is not permissible. So those ayat of al-ahkam, those ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the commands and the prohibition, can we just recite them just like that, or we have to reflect upon them? You have to reflect upon them. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةَ. Okay, this is in the Quran. So when you recite it, you can't just go like that. You can't just bypass it like that. You have to reflect upon this ayat because there are commands. There are commands. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us here to establish the salah and give the zakat. Now when Allah commands us, we need to know the detail of those commands, right? We need to know, how do we know the detail? How can we know the detail about those ahkam, those rulings? How?
By revising the verse and taking time to reflect upon it.
Right. And do we have to go to the tafsir of the scholars? We have to go to the explanation of the Quran? And what are the tafsir, you know, the tafsir that are well known, like the tafsir of al-sunnah that is reliable and you can go to and find those ayat explained there? Like what? At-Tirmidhi? That's a book of hadith. We're talking about tafsir al-Quran, tafsir al-Quran. Give me some of the tafsirs. Ibn Kathir, tafsir al-Imam Ibn Kathir is one of them. So when we have some problems, like we don't understand certain ayat, right? Because, for example, you would not be able to understand the ayat of inheritance. Would you be able to? You would not be able. Like, how much do you give to the father? Or how much do you give to the mother? How much do you give to the daughter? And how much do you give to the son? You know, their share. These things, they need someone who is well-versed in this field of al-fara'id, which is inheritance, right? So we cannot just read those ayat and just go by like that. No, we have to take our time to know exactly what they mean, right? That way we understand the rulings, right? It's very important. Jazakallah khair. What other books of tafsir that we have that are reliable beside Ibn Kathir? Tafsir al-Sheikh Abd al-Rahman ibn Nasir al-Sa'di rahimahullah. And who is he, the teacher of, who is the students? Like the students of Sheikh Abd al-Rahman al-Sa'di. Who is his students? Main students. Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah. Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah al-Aqil, rahimahullah, and others. So what are other tafsir that we can go, that the two that they are reliable? Tafsir al-Tabari, yes. Okay, for the English speaking, like those who don't know Arabic, what do you read? Like what time? Can you give me a title? Which book do you use? Which interpretation of the meaning of the Quran? Like, which one do you use?
The noble Quran.
Noble Quran. Okay, can we use Yusuf Ali?
No.
Why? Yes, absolutely. So we have to be aware also of some of the interpretation of the meaning of the Quran that is not, authentic. That is not authentic. So the second chapter, working and ruling by the Quran. What does the author means by this? Working and ruling by the Quran. What does he mean by that? What does he mean by that? Yes, living your life according to the Quran. Because you can bring a parrot, I kid you not, you can bring a parrot and you teach him how to recite the Quran. He will recite the Quran, right or wrong, right? But so the Quran can be recited even by a bird, you know? So what are the ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned those who just, they have the book of Allah, but they don't implement it? Give me some of the ayat in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the importance of implementing the Quran, implementing the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone can give me some of the ayat from the Quran? Okay, I will start, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and this surah, all of you recite. As a matter of fact, you recited it in the Salat, Surah Al-Fatiha. What did Allah say at the end of it? No. غير المغضوب عليهم. Okay, so you say, إهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Guide us to the straight path, right or wrong. And then you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to, to be like those who are misguided, who are maghdub alayhim, those who earn the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are they? Who are specifically?
The Jews.
Actually, the Jews. The Jews. Why did they earn the anger of Allah? Why?
They know the truth and they distort it.
And they did not implement it. Okay, there is an ayah in Surah Al-Jumu'ah about them. What did Allah say about them in Surah Al-Jumu'ah? Anyone knows the ayah? مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةَ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُ أَسْفَارًا. Right? The similitude of those who were supposed to carry out the Torah, but they did not implement it. It's like a donkey carrying loads of books. Okay, is the donkey going to benefit from those books?
No.
Not going to benefit. So the poet says, كَالْعِيرِ فِي الْبَيْدَاءِ يَقْتُوهَا الضَّمَعُ وَالْمَاءُ عَلَى ظُهُورِهَا مَحْمُولُ. Like camels in the middle of the desert, they're dying of thirst, and they're carrying fresh water on their back. You know? So the intent of this Quran is not only to recite it, but also to implement it. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, I'm going to leave the hadith to you. Give me a hadith that speaks about this. والقرآن والقرآن حجة لك أو عليك والقرآن حجة لك أو عليك. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the Quran is either a proof for you or against you. A proof for you if you implement it and you live by it. A proof against you if you don't implement it, right? And Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, he said, رُبَّ قَارِئٍ لِلْقُرْآنِ وَالْقُرْآنُ يَلْعَنُ. رُبَّ قَارِئٍ لِلْقُرْآنِ وَالْقُرْآنُ يَلْعَنُ. Someone may be reciting Quran, the Quran is cursing him back. What's that? Because he's not implementing the Quran. He's not implementing the Quran. Like, for example, we talk about a merchant, Muslim merchant. He goes through the ayat of riba, right? Of interest and the like. And he still deals with interest. Is this person benefiting from the Quran?
No.
He's not benefiting from the Quran. Very good. So that is the second chapter, the third one. The Shaykh Rahimahullah said, a warning against speaking about the Quran with mere opinion. What does he mean by this?
I mean, don't talk about the Quran unless you're
unless it's factual, but you can't say your own opinion about the Quran.
Very good. Can anyone remember the statement of Abu Bakr Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, when he was asked about the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفَاكِهَةً وَأَبَّا وَفَاكِهَةً fruits and grass, right? وَفَاكِهَةً وَأَبَّا And what did he say? What did Abu Bakr say? You know, remember, Abu Bakr Siddiq, he is the best, right? From this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? He's the best. After the Messenger of Allah from this ummah. Okay, now, this is Abu Bakr Siddiq saying this. It shows you the danger of speaking about the Quran without knowledge. Okay, what did he say? What did Abu Bakr Siddiq say? What did he say? Anybody remember? Naam. He said, the translation of which, no earth, no heaven will shelter me or protect me, and no earth will conceal me. Right? Where? If I say in the book of Allah that which I have no knowledge about. This is Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu say this. It's very dangerous to speak about the Quran without knowledge. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ And do not speak about those matters that you have no knowledge about. So this is very important. And that shows you also that we have to stay away from those people of philosophy and rhetoric. Because they speak without knowledge. They speak with their opinion. So now the chapter is understood, right? So as long as you understand the chapter, this is what matters. This chapter returned the unclear verses to the clear verses. What does he mean by that? Return the unclear verses to the clear verses. What does he mean by this?
Now, so instead of us delving by using the chapter before that,
right,
speaking with no knowledge, now we say, I don't know.
Right.
We don't know everything. Let's do what Allah tells us, ask the people of knowledge if you want.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So there is an ayah in the Quran that speaks about this. Can it, where, what surah is it in? Ali Imran, Ahsant. What is the ayah? Any one of you who did not speak? Jawad, don't look in the book. Gotta put the book down. What's the ayah? Anybody knows the ayah? Fadda. هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب منه آيات فأما الذين وما يعلم تأويله الوقف دن
وراسخون في العلم يقولون آمنا به كل من عند ربنا
وما يتذكر إلا أولو الألباب أحسنت جزاك الله خير So this is the ayah that Sheikh Abdul Razzaq Al-Badr حفظه الله he brought as an evidence to support the statement of the Sheikh رحمه الله الحافظ الحكمي So as for the أهل السنة والجماعة والحمد لله, we don't have an issue. أهل السنة والجماعة, those آيات in the Quran that are unclear, what do we do with them? We refer it back to those آيات that are clear. Like, can anybody give me an example? Anybody from the Quran? Go ahead. No, you can't guess. What did we say the chapter before that? You can't speak without knowledge. Can't guess. You have to be certain. No guessing. There's no guesswork in the Quran. Okay. You have to be certain. Okay. Can anyone give me an example of some of the ayah? One ayah that is unclear, another ayah that is clear. Yes. Okay. These are unclear. طيب Nobody knows the meaning except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, I want something where there is an ayah that is unclear and another ayah that clarifies that ayah. Okay, for example, a non-Muslim, a Christian may come to you and say, you know what? There is Trinity in the Quran. There is the Aqidah of Tathlit, the belief of the Trinity, right? He was saying, well, what do you mean by that? He said, well, your Lord in the Quran, he said, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزِّلْنَا الدِّكْرَ. We sent down Al-Quran, the reminder, Al-Quran, right? So he said, we. Right? Okay, how do you refute that? Is this muhkam or mutashabih? Asking you. Mutashabih. Okay, what is muhkam? قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ وَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدْ. Right? Clear cut. But how do you refute this person if he says we, and we is plural? How do you refute him? We. The royal we. Ahsant. Ahsant. Royal we. Yeah. Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen gave an example. He said, for example, a king, he will say, we build the palace. We build the palace. But did the king himself build the palace? Or his workers build the palace? The workers. Okay. But because the king, he has a majesty. He has, you know, a respectful place. So he used the word we instead of I. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more deserving of that. So if Allah said we, it's the royal we. And it's when someone speaks highly about himself, use we. And Allah has more deserves all of that. طيب. The Shaykh, he said, a warning against argumentation concerning the Qur'an. What does he mean by that?
Yes. Do not argue about what verses in the Qur'an that you don't understand
as well. Ahsant.
They may use it against you to give you shubha in your belief.
Ahsant.
You posted you're not supposed to talk to disbelievers in an argument tone.
Right.
When having a dialogue between them.
Right. Right. Exactly.
Shouldn't you be the
knowledge? Yes, absolutely. Very good, mashallah. Implementing the commands of the Quran and avoid the its prohibition. What does he mean by this? Right, very good. So how would you know the details? Like for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would mention some command in the Quran and some prohibitions. But he did not mention the detail of those commands and those prohibitions. Where do we go to know the details? Yes, ahsant, the sunnah. Because the sunnah explains the Quran. Can anyone give me an example of some ayat that were explained by the sunnah? Yes. The prayer, very good. Zakat also, because zakat, you don't find 2.5% in the Quran, do you? How much do you give? 2.5%, right? Is it in the Quran? You don't find the Quran. Okay, and in this also is a refutation against the Quraniyun. You know those people who claim that they can take only from the Quran. You know, there's a sect, they say we can take only from the Quran. We don't need the Sunnah. Is that possible?
No.
It's not possible. Because if that was possible, then there is no need for us to know the details of the ruku' and sujood and what you say in ruku', what you say in sujood and all those details and the details of the zakat and hajj and other than that. You know? So it's very important to know the command and the prohibitions. Also, one of the ways to know them is the books of fiqh. Because the books of fiqh, they are very detailed. Like, for example, Al-Mulakhas Al-Fiqhi, a summary of Islamic jurisprudence by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. It's very detailed about the affairs of Salat, Zakat, Hajj, and other than that. Yes. Because the Quran, he mentioned those commands and those prohibitions, but they are not detailed. Yeah, there are some ahkam that are detailed. Like, for example, inheritance is clear. It's very detailed in Surah An-Nisa. Right? But there are some ahkam ruling, they are not detailed. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the Quran, and he said in it, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الدِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ النَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِ. And we send down to you this reminder, Al-Quran, so that you can clarify to the people what has been sent down to them. So it is the job of the Messenger of Allah to clarify Al-Quran. And then the Shaykh, he mentioned the unclear verses in the Quran. He said, rahimahullah ta'ala, that those ayat that are unclear, those ayat that which is unclear, then entrust it to its God. And do not delve into it, because you're delving into it, it will cause punishment. Why would he say that? Right. Like, can you give me an example? Right. If someone start arguing about, I know the meaning of it, and they start arguing with other people, this is condemned, because no one knows the meaning of Alif Lam Mim and those broken letters, right? The Huruf Muqatta'a in the beginning of the surah, except Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. No one knows the real meaning. Another example. The reality of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that He has hands that befits His majesty. That He will come on the day of the judgment in a way that befits His majesty. He rose over the throne in a way that befits His majesty. Right? Okay, we affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose over the throne. But how did He rise over the throne? Is unknown. So someone to delve into this is haram. He could be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because now he's going to an area that he has no knowledge about. He doesn't know the reality of these attributes. You see, Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they affirm the meaning of those attributes. But how they are, they leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And can anyone remember the statement of Imam Malik, rahimahullah, when one of the innovators, he came and he asked him, he said, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa kayfa istawa. The most gracious Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he rose over the throne, and in this innovator, he said, how did Allah rise over the throne? Which is impermissible to ask. No. Yes. What did Imam Malik say to this man? No, he said, al-istiwa'u ma'lum. He said, al-istiwa'u ma'lum. This is very, pay attention to this. He said, he rose over the throne is known to us. Right? Wal-kayf, and how did he rise over the throne is unknown to us. Wal-imanu, and to believe in that is wajib. Wal-su'alu anhu, and to ask a question, how, is what? Bid'ah. Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, when he was explaining this, he said the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, they were the most eloquent of all the people. And they were the most righteous and most pious. They had so much taqwa and wara. They never asked a question like that. Never asked a question like that in Aqeedah. And what did Imam Malik do with that man? What did he do with him? He told them to get escorted outside the masjid. You see? Why? Why do we have to get rid of Ahlul Bid'ah and not to let them lay, as they say, lay their eggs and have their chicks? Because, right? Why?
Because it can influence the rest.
Ahsant. Jazakallah khair. Barakallah fiqh. Very good, mashallah. So This chapter, alhamdulillah, is clear. We're going to go to the other chapter. A warning from the people of deviance, innovation, and misguidance. What does this chapter talk about? What about others? You know, why don't you... Subhanallah. The brother is running the show.
No, there is a light here to speak.
Really? Okay, tafadhal.
Stay away from the people who innovate.
Yes.
And who claim to be clear to know what they're on, but you're lying.
Yes, very good. MashaAllah. Jazakallah khair. Very dangerous. The people of innovation, they are very dangerous. Sheikh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said their harm is far greater than a conquering army. Than a conquering army. Why? Because the conquering army, what they're going to do? Yeah, they're going to kill people or they're going to destroy what? The structure of the city, right? But can they destroy the aqidah?
No.
They can't. But Ahlul Bid'ah, what do?
They spread
false aqaid, false belief. They tamper with the Quran in their not. They cannot change the Quran in terms of the wording and things like that. But what they do, they misinterpret the Quran. They misinterpret the Quran. Can anyone give me some of the misinterpretation of the people of of Ahl al-Bid'ah, the people of innovation? Like what? Yes, nation. Yes, who else? Okay, let me give you an example. Al-Jahmiyyah, the followers of Al-Jahm bin Safwan. What do they say about the attribute of Allah? Do you know what they say about the attribute of Allah? Do they affirm them? Do they affirm the attribute of Allah? They do or they don't? All of you agree? Yes, they don't. What does it mean when they don't affirm the attribute of Allah? What does it mean? Since what?
Because they don't like in him, they don't believe in his attributes because they say they're like affirming it and it's like liking him to his.
Yes, because they claim if they affirm the attribute of Allah, this would necessitate, right, that they're going to liken Allah to his creation. Do you understand? Okay, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa huwa as-sami'ul basir. That he is the all-hearing, the all-seeing, right? Okay. We, Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, we affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears and sees in a way that befits his majesty, right? Okay. These deviant sects, this dangerous deviant sect, they don't affirm this. They say if we affirm that Allah sees and hears, this would necessitate that we're going to liken him to his creation. Is that true? Is that true or not? I'm asking you. No, it's not. So how do you refute them? Allah, there is nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, we are human, we hear and we see. But our hearing and sight is limited. Right or wrong? Can you hear what's in the street now? You can't. But you can hear only what's here. But Allah hears everything and sees everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see? So that is the first thing that they do. They don't affirm the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they don't affirm the names also. The names of Allah. Why is it that they don't affirm the names of Allah? Anybody knows? Why? Okay, but why they deny the names of Allah? They don't affirm the names of Allah. Why? What's the reason?
Because they know that the truth is in the names. They don't want to acknowledge it.
They don't acknowledge them. So if they acknowledge them, they would affirm them. They don't affirm the names of Allah. Why? Taha.
They would necessitate more than one pillar.
Yes, ta'addud al-aliyah. Because they claim, Sheikh Al-Fawzan, he mentioned this, they claim that if they affirm the names of Allah, this would necessitate they would have what? Multiple deities. Do you understand? Do you understand, brothers? Anybody can clarify? I want to make sure that you understand. Huh? Like what? Give me an example. Make it clear. The names of Allah. Rahim, Malik al-Quddus. Is it one ilah or they are different deities? Okay, good. Very good. Alhamdulillah. Now you understand that these people, they're very dangerous. So we have to stay away from them. We have to stay far away from these people of innovation. Right? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to warn against innovation. Can anybody give me a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he warned against innovation? Okay, can you mention the whole hadith, if you can? My ummah will be divided into? 73. All of it will be in there? Except one. Which is this one? Those who are upon what I am upon today and my followers. Okay, there is an ayah in the Quran. I want you to give me the ayah that conforms with this hadith. The ayah from the Quran that conforms with this hadith.
I have not created
gender of mankind. La. La. That this is my straight path, follow it. Do not follow other paths. And also the ayah when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَن يُشَقِقِ الرَّسُولِ مِن بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى ويتبع غير سبيل المؤمنين نوليه ما تولى ونصليه جهنم وساءت مصيرا. Whoever opposes the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam after guidance has been clarified to him and follows a way other than the way of the believers, who are the believers? The sahaba رضوان الله عليهم, سلف الصحابه. نوليه ما تولى, we'll leave him in that path that he had chosen, and we will land him in the hellfire. What an evil destination. It shows you here the requirement not only to follow the messenger, but to follow the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. So it's a must for us to follow the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Because why is it that we have to follow the Sahaba? Why?
Because they're
Yes, what else? There's something very important for you to know. They witness the revelation. They witness what?
The revelation.
Quran came down while they were there. So they understood the Quran better than all of us. And they understood the Sunnah better than us. And that's why in Tafsir Ibn Kathir, for example, or Tafsir al-Tabari, the scholars, what do they use? The Tafsir of who? No. At-Tabari Ibn Kathir. What tafsir do they use? Yeah. Ikhwan, do you need coffee or some tea or something like that? they use the tafsir of who? The Sahaba, companions. Tafsir Ibn Abbas. Right or wrong? Now, طيب. He said, it is as though, this chapter, it is as though the reciter of the Quran is addressing the most merciful. What does he mean by that? What does he mean by this statement?
So, when we pray, we are standing in front of Allah, so we speak the speech of Allah, asking him for guidance.
Right. Yes. Anyone wants to add more? Yes.
It makes a lot. One part is for Allah and the other part is for...
Yes. What is the Hadith Qudsi? Can anybody just mention the beginning of that Hadith Qudsi? Yes. Yeah, between me, myself, and my servant. in two halves. So when the servants say, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Allah responds to him. Hamidani Abdi, my servant has praised me. And so on and so forth. So basically the salat, you are getting involved in a conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it shows you the importance of this prayer. And Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said that the importance of the prayer, it was so important because Allah loves it. And because Allah loves it, it was supposed to be how many? 50. Shows you how Allah loves the prayer. But Allah, out of His mercy and grace, He reduced it to 5 times a day, but with the reward of 50. You get 50 times the reward, even though you pray only 5 times. So 5 in number, but 50 a reward. Now, the author, he said, the description of the noble Quran. Can you give me some of the ayat where Allah described Al-Quran? Some of the description of the Quran. Some of the description of the Quran. Like what? Give me some ayat. Some of the description of the Quran. Yes. Hudan lil-muttaqin. Okay, Alif Lam Mim, Dalik al-Kitab. That book, there is no doubt in it. Hudan lil-muttaqin, guidance for those who are pious. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentioned that the Quran is a guidance. This is a description of the Quran. Can you give me another description from the Quran? Naam. It is for those who believe, hudan, guidance and healing. Tabarak alladhi nazzala. What's the ayah? I am giving you the beginning of it. Al-Furqan, ala abdihi, liyakuna lil-alamin nadira. Blessed is the one who sent down this criterion, Al-Quran. So he called it what? Criterion. He called it criterion here. What is criterion? What does it mean by criterion? Criterion. Anyone can give us the meaning? Huh? لا. Doesn't mean that. Criterion. Al-Furqan. What is Al-Furqan? Yes. The divider between the truth and falsehood. That's Al-Furqan. You say Fulan ليس عنده Furqan. You say person so and so. He doesn't have a Furqan. He doesn't have a criterion. Yeah, he does not. He sits with Ahlul Bid'ah, and then he goes and sits with Ahlul Sunnah. This person has a Furqan? He doesn't have a Furqan. Nah. طيب. So the point is, the Quran has many of this description that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like for example, Allah called the Quran Nur, enlightenment. He called it Hudan, guidance, Shifa, healing, Rahmah, mercy, and other than that. Here in this chapter, the Quran is a healer for the people of the faith who works by it. What does he mean by this?
The Quran is a healer for the people who take the Quran, listen to it, and apply it.
Yes. Okay, so how do you describe it to be a healer? What's the effect of the Quran? Like, if you apply it, like, let's say you apply the Quran, what is the effect of the Quran on you?
You become a better Muslim.
Yes, very good.
You're an obedient slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
What about the spiritual healing?
It strengthens your iman.
It strengthens your iman, and also it takes away what? Depression.
Anxiety.
And things like, I'm going to tell you, I know him personally, he used to be bipolar. And you know, bipolarism is not easy. It's not easy because the people who are bipolar, they change. Like they have a double personality. They may be happy one moment and the next moment they become sad and depressed and they want to commit suicide. Yes. So in order for them to be stable, they had to take what?
Medicine.
Medicine. Okay. This person, I know him personally. He used to take medication, and he told me that he was debating to kill himself. Yeah. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him, and he stopped the medication altogether. He does not take medication anymore. And I asked him, I said, what's the secret? He said, Quran. He started reciting Quran every day. Alhamdulillah, he doesn't have that problem anymore. You see? Quran is very important. Now, can anyone share with me the story of the Sahaba? The scorpion sting. Yes.
The people in the town didn't want to help them. So their leader was plunged by a scorpion.
Yes.
They tried all types of method and nothing was working. So one of them said, what about the travelers?
Right.
And they went to them and they said, we could heal them, but in return we need a flock of sheep.
Right. Subhanallah. Look at that. But subhanallah, look, the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum. The same Quran we recite. We recite the surah. Don't we recite the surah?
Yes.
And it might not work for certain people, even though they recite Al-Quran. But it will work with other people. What's the secret ingredient? Why? Why is it that Al-Quran worked for Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, and Umar radiallahu anhu, and Al-Imam ibn al-Qayyim, and there are many examples, right? But why is it some people recite the Quran, but it does not have any effect on them? Why is that?
Because
or on someone else who is sick? Why?
Because sometimes they won't have faith.
They won't have faith, period, you mean? Or they have faith, but they are not strong? Because when you say they don't have faith, means they're not Muslims, they're not believers.
Oh, no, their faith is not strong.
It's not strong. Very good, mashallah. Good, good. So when someone's faith is very strong, and they have ikhlas, sincerity, and they depend upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure that person, not because of them, but they're just a mean. Right? Then Allah cures them. Cures them. This happens many times with a lot of people. وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدِ So Quran is also شفاء. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ And we send down from this Quran that which is a healing and a mercy for the believers. The Shaykh رحمه الله تعالى here, he said, those who implement it on the day of return, for them will be the best guide to the gardens of paradise. What does he mean by that? Okay, I'm going to repeat again. He said, those who implement it, means implement the Quran, means they live by it and they work by it, right? On the day of return, means what is the day of return? The day of judgment, okay? For them will be the best guide to the gardens of paradise. What does he mean by that? Yes.
They'll already know what to do. But
how will the Quran lead them to paradise?
Because the Quran explains.
No, we're not talking about leading to paradise. Try to stick to the topic. You're very close, but just stick to the topic.
Can you repeat the question?
Brother. Okay. Those who implement it on the day of return, those who implement the Quran, those who live by the Quran, implement the Quran, on the day of return means the day of judgment, for them will be the best guide to the gardens of paradise. That's the reason? Anybody has anything? It's very clear. The statement of the Sheikh is very clear. The Quran will be their guide to paradise. Subhanallah. The Quran will lead them to Al-Jannah, to paradise. If you live by it, then what's going to happen? You're going to go to Jannah, inshallah, because you obeyed Allah. You fulfilled the obligations and you stayed away from the prohibitions, right? So it would lead you to Jannah. Now, there is an ayah in Surah Al-An'am. I gave you a hint now. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. Those who believe, do not mix their iman with shirk. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ. Those they will have security and safety in this world and next. And they will be guided in this world and the next. Will be guided to Sirat al-Mustaqim here, and you will be guided to Jannat al-Firdaus. May Allah make us from them. Ameen. طيب. We're going to go to the, because the time is catching up with us. The virtue of Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran. Can anybody give me some of the benefits of these two surahs? What is the benefit of learning Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran, reciting them, living by them? What is the benefit that you gain in the next world? What's the benefit? They will intercede for the one who recite them, act upon them, they will intercede for him. So they will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah like what? Like they will shade, yes. Cloud and yes, but like flocks of birds, they will shade that person and intercede. The Shaykh, he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, sufficient for you is the Quran as a continuous miracle, always with us, never departed. Okay, why would he say that? Why would he say that the Quran is a continuous miracle? Why would he say that? Yes.
Because it helps people who are with lots of faith in ways that sometimes you can't imagine.
Like, why is the Quran a miracle? Why is it a miracle?
It speaks about the advancements and stuff that there's in the Quran that's happening today.
Because in every generation, the miracle is the Quran still showing. At the time of the Prophet Muhammad,
right.
Sahaba, it was some miracle.
Very good.
In our time, there
is a miracle too.
In the future,
exactly. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged the creation with this Quran. That in itself is a miracle, right or wrong. That in itself is a miracle. So the people, they will not be able to produce the like of this Quran, even if the jinn and human were to get together. So the miracle of the Quran, they're continuous. Not only at the time of the Arabs who excelled in the Arabic language, but also at this time also, it is still a miracle. No one can produce the like of this Quran. And the Quran, there was one American critic, he's a book critic. So he wanted to find something in the Quran, some flaws, some discrepancies, anything that he could find. So he began from Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Fatiha, then Surah Al-Baqarah, then Surah Al-Imran, then when he reached Surah Al-Nisa, he accepted Islam. He accepted Islam because it was overwhelming for him. It was too overwhelming. He could not find anything. He's going to wear himself out, you know? And the Quran is very challenging. Subhanallah. Very powerful, full of miracles. And the miracles of all the prophets and messengers, they're longer and longer here. Like for example, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, what miracle did he have? What did he have?
He was given
one. What are the miracles of Isa, Jesus, peace be upon him, Isa?
Healer.
Healer, what, like what? Can you give me an example? Those who had leprosy or blindness, or the, he was deaf or dumb or something like that, he will just rub his hand on him and then Allah will heal him. Sometimes he will call someone from the dead, right? So are those miracles still alive or they're gone? But the Quran is still there. You see, that's what the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, meant by continuous. Very important to understand the text. Writing is good, but writing with fahm, understanding, is even better. We go to the next chapter. The Quran is a superior witness. What does he mean by that? I'm going to read to you what the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala said. It is a superior witness in the Arabic language with no crookedness, affirming what came in the scripture from before. So the Quran is a witness for what came in other scriptures. Like what?
The Torah.
Yes. Ahsant. 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 Very good. Right. The Quran contains laws and information about the past nations. Can anyone give me some ayat from the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the past nations? Pharaoh, like what?
People of Nuh,
people of Ad, people of Thamud, and other than them, right? So, for example, you read Surah Al-A'raf. You find the story of the prophets, peace be upon them, and their nations. So why did Allah mention these stories? For what? What's the reason? And what else? Information and what else?
Lessons
for us to take heed from that. That way we don't fall in the same errors that they have fallen into. Because many of these nations, they were what? Were destroyed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He destroyed them. You see? Because they did not obey that messenger that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to them. After he clarified the message to them, they did not obey him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them. So for when we read those ayat, we reflect. We reflect upon them. And we don't fall into the same mistake and the same stubbornness that those people were involved in. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala says, the Quran explains the legislative rulings in a clear, easy method. Look at the explanation of the rules of the legislation. Do you see in anything difficult? Unresolved. The Quran explains the legislative ruling. What are the legislative ruling? What are they? Legislative. What does he mean by legislative?
The laws.
Of what? Of the Sharia, of the legislation. Legislation, Sharia is Kitab wa Sunnah. This is Sharia. Right? So the Quran explains it. Can anyone give me an example from the Quran? The Quran is clear cut, explains the ruling. Anyone?
Heritage.
Inheritance.
Yes.
Ahsant. Inheritance. What else? Riba. What about Siyam, fasting? What did Allah say about it? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. Do you find any difficulty understanding this? You don't. It's very clear. Yes, there are some details in the sunnah, like for example, the nullifiers of the fast. You may not find all of them in the Quran. So you find them in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in general, the Quran is clear. It's very clear. The Quran calls to everything good and prevents everything evil. Okay, the Shaykh, he said, or is there some good which it does not guide the creation to? Or a door of destruction it does not prevent or blame? What does he mean by this? Quran calls to everything good and prevents everything evil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we did not send you except as a mercy for mankind, for the whole world, right? Okay, mercy necessitates, right, that he will teach them that which will benefit them. And he will warn them against those things that will harm them. And that's why Sheikh Abdurrahman bin Sa'di rahimahullah, he said, الدين مبني على المصالح في جلبها والدرء للقبائح. The religion of Islam is based upon bringing about what? Benefit and warding off harm and evil. So this religion is about that. The Quran is like that. The Quran commands you to do that which is good and prevents you from doing that which is bad. Like, can you give an example of something that the Quran commands you to do which is good? Like what? Give zakat. And what's the opposite of not giving zakat? Being selfish and stingy. You see. Is it good to be stingy?
No.
Yes. And the person who is stingy, he's going to harm what?
Himself.
And is he, this person who is stingy, is he a good contributing factor in the Muslim society?
No.
He's not. No. Okay. You want to say something? Yes. Interest. Ahsant. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. It's a good example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made a sales transaction halal. And he made riba haram. You see. Okay. Sale, like for example, you bought this bottle of water from me for $1. Right? So I paid 50 cents, for example. I made 50 cents profit. Alhamdulillah, this is sale. This is good. Riba is what? Can you give me an example of riba?
Let's say you bought a car, and you bought a car, we couldn't afford it, so you took out a loan.
Right.
But, and you know you're going to have to pay for loan, but you're also going to have to pay extra interest.
Right.
That's
haram, because that is exploiting actually the people who can't afford to buy those cars or those houses and the like. It's haram. And the ulama, they say, كُلُّ دَيْنٍ جَرَّ إِلَى مَنْفَعَ فَهُوَ riba. Every loan that leads to an interest or a benefit is haram. It is riba. The sheikh, he said, or is there equivalent to a dare kernel that which is not need of its guidance due to all the system from inhabitants of the earth. Man-made laws are not independent of needing the guidance of the Quran. What does he mean by this? Yes.
To basically following his commands in order to achieve success from the smallest things to the biggest of things.
Right. Ahsant. Very good, mashallah. Everybody understand this? Because we're running out of time. The Quran contains admonitions and lessons. So he said, its news is an admonition. Its examples are lessons. All of it is amazing. What does he mean by that? What are the exhortations in the Quran? Can anybody give me an exhortation from the Quran?
The admonitions is like the stories of the past nations that have been chastised.
Yeah, lessons learned from that. But what about the admonition? Like what? Can you give me an admonition?
Warnings.
Like what? Give me an example from the Quran. An ayah from the Quran, which is an admonition. Wal asr, inna al-insana lafi khusr. Is that admonition or not? What did Imam Shafi'i say about this surah? Anybody knows?
If this was the only verse.
If this surah?
If this surah was the only surah given to us, it would have been sufficient for us.
Would be sufficient for the creation. Because it's the greatest admonition for us. Huh? حجة على الخلق. حجة على الخلق. Yes. As an argument against the creation, as a proof against the creation, except this surah, it would have been enough. Because in it is a great exhortation. There are other exhortations. كل نفس دائقة الموت. Every soul shall taste death. Is this an exhortation or not? So when you read it, you reflect upon it. طيب. Move on, inshallah. To the he said the jinn who heard the Quran from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the jinn did not linger when they. You can see this very well, subhanallah. When they tilted it to listen before rushing to warn their people, so the jinn who heard the Quran from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right away, when they heard the Quran, they went to their people and they gave them an admonition. Okay, what does this mean? What does it mean?
Warning
that the jinn, they benefited from the Quran. And then you find some jinn better than human because they listen to the Quran and they follow the Quran and they live by the Quran, you know? Some human beings, they don't do that, you know? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I did not create jinn and human except for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the jinn also benefits from the Quran. The miracle of the noble Quran, the Shaykh, he said, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. It contains lessons of clarity and wisdom. What does he mean by this? Quran contains lessons of clarity and wisdom. It's clear cut, full of wisdom. Full of wisdom. The failure of those who try to emulate the Quran. The failure of those who try to emulate the Quran. What does it mean? No one can produce the like of this Quran. Yes. Remember Musaylim al-Kaddab, the great liar Musaylima. He tried, but he was unsuccessful. He was unsuccessful. And also Al-Ustad Abu Muhammad, Zawallahu Khair, he mentioned the story of those Canadians, right?
Yes.
Canadians. Remember? What happened to them?
They tried to replicate the Quran, but failed miserably.
Right. Very good. This chapter, the Quran challenges the eloquent experts of the Arabic language. What does he mean by that?
The poets of the time.
Yes. The Quran challenged them. And what is the wisdom that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was unlettered, and he brought this magnificent Quran to them, and they were not able to emulate the Quran. What's the wisdom? Right, because if he was, well educated, then if he knew how to write and read and all this, they would have said, well, this is from him. But subhanallah, even though he was unlettered, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he brought this Quran to them and they could not emulate the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged them to bring the like of this Quran and they could not bring it. In the other chapter, he said, jinn and man can never produce anything similar to the Quran. Can anybody give me an ayah from the Quran? Surah Al-Isra. Surah Al-Isra. Surah Al-Isra. Surah Al-Isra. And I believe Surah Al-Nisa also has an ayah.
Say if mankind and jinn were together.
You're looking in the book. It's okay. Go ahead, read it.
Say if mankind and jinn were together to produce the like of this Quran,
nah,
they could not produce the like thereof, even if they helped one another.
Ahsant. Very good. There is another ayah, Surah, I believe Surah Al-Nisa. Correct me if I'm wrong. قل لو كان من غير what's the ayah? من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا. نعم. ولو كان, if this Quran was from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would have found in it much what? Contradiction. But because it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it has no contradiction. Okay, inshallah, we're gonna finish with this chapter. This is the last chapter. The author, rahimahullah, he said, the Quran is the speech of Allah sent down upon the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It was not created nor composed by our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And it is not an expression possessing a soul. What does he mean by that? Yes, very good.
It is the direct speech from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Ahsant. And the Quran is not created. It's not. Why would the author mention that the Quran is not created? He could have said the Quran is the speech of Allah, and that's it. Why would he say the Quran is not created?
So the people who dispute the Quran, they cannot say that somebody wrote it.
Made it up. And yes. Okay, from that angle, I understand. There is another angle. Like when refuting the people of innovation. Okay, why would he say uncreated? Why? Why would he say uncreated?
Because if they said that it was created, then it would mean that Allah is part of the creation. Whereas that is, if it's uncreated and Allah is not part of the creation, Allah created.
But who says the Quran is created? Who? Remember, Ikhwan. Subhanallah, Al-Jahmiya. Ahsant. Al-Jahmiya. So Al-Jahmiya, they claim Al-Quran, they believe Al-Quran is created. This is false. This is false. Because Al-Quran is the speech of Allah. And the speech of Allah cannot be created. Why? Because it is not part of the creation. Ahsant. Okay, there is another sect. They claim Al-Quran, what is in the Mus'haf is an expression of that represents the speech of Allah. What are they? Al-Asha'ira or Al-Asha'ris. Those are the ones that say Al-Quran, which is in the Mus'haf, is not Quran. It is Ibarah and Kalamillah, means an expression of the speech of Allah. Tayyib? And also Al-Maturidiyya and also Al-Kullabiyya, these are the people of deviation. But Ahlul Sunnah, Alhamdulillah, they affirm the speech of Allah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say Allah speaks in a way that befits His Majesty. And the Quran is His speech. And it is not created. And that's the end of the book. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all Al-Ilm al-Nafi' wal-Amal al-Salih. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.